We just thank you right now, and we bless your holy name. You're awesome and wonderful. Father, we need you to use my mind and my mouth and my body, everything that's within me, to impart a well-timed word into the hearts of your people. Father, we're praying right now, God, that you would just open the door, God. God, for us to receive more revelation and more comfort, God, and more conviction. Because, God, we want to be like you. God, you said you would perfect us, God, until you came. Continue to perfect us through your word today. So, Father, we come against every foul spirit, every demonic presence that will come to steal, kill, or destroy the seed of your word that is being planted or watered in the hearts of your people even now. So, Father, it's in Jesus' name that we pray this prayer by faith. And everybody who can agree with that, can you say amen? Let's give the Lord a hand clap of praise. Amen. Amen. Luke chapter 5, verse 37 through 39 is our text for this morning. We enter a text where Christ is speaking to the disciples and he is training them. And I found it interesting this week as I was looking at this particular verse. And I wanted to share it, what God had shown me. Starting in verse 37, the word of God reads, "And no man puts new wine into old skin or wineskin bottles, else the new wine will burst the wineskin bottles and itself be spilled. And the wineskin bottles will perish. But the new wine must be put into new or fresh wineskin bottles. And no man, having drunk old wine, desires new wine. For he says, the old is good." Can the church say amen? Wine throughout the Bible has been used in various forms and fashions. It has been used for medicinal purposes. Paul says to Timothy, use a little wine for your stomach as a remedy. You find that wine is used by Christ to perform a miracle, as he used the water vases that were used for ceremonial cleansing and turned them all to wine at the marriage feast at Cana. You find that wine was used in combination with sacrifices in the Old Testament. You find that wine has been forbidden to priests while on duty and forbidden to Nazarites like Samson, to keep them pure before God. You find that wine also was used in the wilderness, denied to the Israelites so that they would know that God was their only supplier of joy. You find that in this particular case, wine is used in reference to the Spirit of God and to new life. Can you say amen? You find that the wineskin bottles referenced here are made out of two different types, skin or of leather. And they're used to carry wine and water and milk. They are typically goat skin, turned inside out and filled and tanned with acacia bark. And the wine, when used in these particular ways, are allowed to ferment. And if the skin is old, it's not malleable. It's not flexible, and it tends to burst easy. But wine is was put into new skin so that as the wine fermented and expanded and grew, and you found that the skins were able to expand with it. Job said in 32, this 32nd chapter in the 19th verse, that my belly is as wine which has no vent. It is ready to burst like new bottles. Look at your neighbor and say, new wine is for new bottles. Chuck Swindoll, a famous preacher and author, said, the longer I live, the more I realize the impact of attitude on my life. Attitude to me is more important than facts. It's more important than the past, than education, than money, than circumstances, than failures, than successes, than whatever people think, say, or do. It is more important than appearance and giftedness or skill. It will make or break a company, a church, a home. The remarkable thing is we have a choice every day regarding the attitude we embrace for that day. We cannot change our past. We cannot change the fact that people will act a certain way. We cannot change the inevitable. The only thing we can do is play the one string we have, and that is our attitude. He said, I am convinced that life is 10% of what happens to me and 90% of how I react to it. And so it is with us. We are in charge of our attitudes. I want to talk to us from the title today, Stretch Me, Lord. Look at your neighbor and say, the Lord wants to stretch you. We look in Luke chapter 5 and verse 37. And as we look through the example that Christ has given dealing with new wineskin bottles and old wineskin bottles, you find that he relates or he assumes certain things about the parable. And watch what he says, or we can assume certain things about the parable. And he says, no man puts new wine in old wineskin bottles. No man. And that assumes that man or woman or adult, mature person or sensible person. No sensible person, no mature person, no adult would put new wine in old bottles. He goes on to say that the new wine will burst the bottles, the wineskin bottles, and the wine would be spilled and the skins will be destroyed or they will perish. Can I tell you that new wine expands? New wine grows. And this new wine that he's talking about, we can relate to the spirit or our spirit. That once Christ has come in and renewed a right mind and a right spirit in us, that it must grow. It cannot sit in us and not grow. It will expand. And you find that when we speak of, or Christ speaks of, these old wine bottles, he is talking about us. In our carnal nature, in our old nature, that old man, that old woman that resides inside of us, that resists expansion, that is not keen on opening up to new possibilities, that part of us that is stubborn, that part of us that is sinful, that part of us that is selfish, that does not want to grow in the Lord, that has given up to change. that is stuck in its old ways. Can I tell you that the two cannot coexist? Life cannot coexist with death. Light is against darkness. Good is against bad. Flesh is against the spirit. They cannot coexist with one another. And the word of God says that the wineskin bottle will be destroyed if you try to make them coexist. If you have new life in you, if you have accepted Christ as Lord and Savior, but you refuse to change your carnal nature, you are on a road to destruction. Can you say amen? You are on a road that will lead to put a position in you where you are of no more use. Jesus says that the wine may be spilled, but you will be destroyed. How many people know that if the wine spills, you can just place it in another vessel? You may be in here today and maybe you have sought Christ, or maybe Christ is knocking on your door, but you refuse to change. You refuse to grow, but something inside of you is stirring and you're fighting and it's a conflict. If you keep resisting, you're going to burst. Look at your neighbor and say, stretch me, stretch me, stretch me. We need God to stretch us. And you find in 38, he says that the new wine must be put into fresh wine skins, that both may be preserved. That word preserved right there, can I tell you that it means to be treasured? It means to have an abundance of something or growth in something. And so new wine must be in a new bottle. It has to be in a new bottle. And if you have received Christ, you have to be renewed in your spirit. You have to be a new creation. You have to, because if you're not, if you hold on to your past, if you hold on to the carnal things of the world, you are going to burst. Somebody needs to say amen. Are you in conflict today? Are you wrestling with yourself today? Have you committed yourself to the process? Because there is a process. And as God works on you, as he stirs inside of you, as you sit here, God is working on you. And he is growing. He is stirring. And if you resist, it's going to be uncomfortable. Can you say amen? They both have to grow together. You have to grow with the spirit. You cannot be mature in here and a baby out there. Can you say amen? Let me come a little closer to home. You can't be spiritual. You can't be so heavenly minded that you're no earthly good. You cannot sit in here and say amen and know all the songs, but you go out there and you're a hellion. You are resisting. You are holding on to your old wineskin self. And God is requiring you to be a new wineskin, that you can grow and that you can expand. And so you won't be creepy. Look at your neighbor and say, don't be creepy. I don't know any creepy people. I know creepy people. They're so super spiritual. I remind a story when I used to work at the bank, and a lady used to come in all the time and bless the Lord. Scare me to death. Hey, how you doing? It's good to bless the Lord. Time out. Okay, we excited about Jesus, amen. Just don't yell it in the bank. You could have said, bless the Lord, how you doing? And one day I'm sitting at my desk in the back, and I hear somebody just going off on the tellers. Oh, man, they're yelling. Man, they're cutting them down. They're doing all kinds. And I just have to get up because nobody's saying anything. And I just have to get up out of my desk, walk around the corner, and see who in the world could this be treating people so bad. And I come around the corner, and guess who it was? And I just tapped her on the shoulder, and I said, bless the Lord. And she was like, oh, preacher, oh, well, man, he just made me so mad. But you lost all of your testimony. All of your testimony in one fell swoop. And when she walked out, that's what they said. I couldn't believe she said that. Every time I talk to her, she's always talking about bless the Lord. She's always talking. I couldn't believe she said that to me. I couldn't believe she was cursing. I couldn't believe that. Sometimes there is a disconnect where you can sit and know the word. You can sit and read the word and quote the scriptures and finish my sentences while I quote the Bible. But there's something about your attitude. There's something about your demeanor. There's something about how you deal with situations under pressure that reveals if you're expanding or not. Look at your neighbor and say, keep expanding, keep expanding, keep expanding. Well, watch this. So is the Spirit stretching you? Are you at a place where you're not being stretched? You should never come to church and sit there and say, Amy, hey, he wasn't talking to me. Ain't nobody step on my toes. I didn't get anything out of it. If you are like that, then you're not expanding. Maybe I'm not preaching right. Maybe I'm not reading the word right. Maybe we're on a different page, but you ought to be growing. Are you about to burst? I know that's strange because we say, amen, hallelujah. Maybe you're about to burst. Maybe that smile is not one where it's a joyful smile. Maybe it's a painful smile. Amen. Amen. I see there's some signs that you're about to burst, and I just want to share a couple with you that you're uncomfortable. Yeah, you're uncomfortable in church. That you've been at a church for years, but you still don't feel like you're a member. You've been at a church for years, and you still feel you're a stranger. That maybe you're in confusion, and maybe, yeah, you're in church and you're praising, but you're confused all the time. You don't know if you're him or her. You don't know if you're here or there. You don't know if you want to be good or bad or right or wrong or et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. And you're in a state of confusion. Not sure if you want to be a man of God. You're not sure if you want to be a woman of God. You're not sure if you want to be the party animal. You're not sure if you want to be 20 when you're 50. Can somebody say amen? Yeah. You're just not sure. You're confused. And that is a sign that you are starting to burst and you're agitated. You're under conviction. So you sit in church and you feel bad all the time. And so you say, I don't like going to church because every time I go to church, I feel like he's stepping on my toes and feel like somebody told him my business and I'm mad and you told him something and he knows something and somebody gossiping at the church. How could he know that? How could he preach about that? I mean, on and on and on. But it is the Spirit trying to grow you, but you're resisting conviction. And you switch conviction into condemnation. And so you sit in church and you say, I don't like going to church because I feel like I want to cry. And I'm sitting there about to cry and I feel that I got to do something different. And I feel that I got to change my life. And I don't like feeling like that because I'm tough. Because it keeps reminding me of my issues. And I keep thinking about how I messed up. And I keep thinking about how I messed over them. And I keep thinking about my failures. And so I don't like that feeling. So I'm not going back. And instead of saying, God, grow me. Instead of saying, God, stretch me. Instead of acknowledging that God is trying to take you to the next level. you are resisting. And you're about to burst and you cannot take it. You come to church, you're mad. You're mad at God. You're mad at church. Yeah. There's some people out there mad at church. And so they'll say that I don't have to go into church. Church is a man-made institution. Church, you can have church at home. I can watch it on TV all the time. I don't have to go to church to love God. But the word says don't forsake church. The word says that we find comfort and training and love in the body of Christ. The word says that when we come together, that we pray and we touch and agree. That's totally opposite from you isolating yourself. Somebody need to say amen. Somebody need to say, stretch me, Lord. And so you find that those are signs that if you are about to burst, you have to be careful. God is trying to move you in a certain direction. Watch this. Paul was vexed. Or Saul, rather, in the Old Testament, the first king of Israel, he was vexed in 1 Samuel 15, verse 20. And his vexation led to spiritual conflict. And it caused him to lose the kingdom. And then later on, his very mind. See, if we don't expand as God is trying to grow us, if we don't change, it's going to drive us crazy. It's going to tear us up. And many people who have refused to grow in Christ, their families have been torn up. Their lives have been torn up. Why? Because God is going to allow your life to fall apart if you're trying to do it yourself. Don't burst. Change. Be a new wineskin bottle. Don't be an old wineskin bottle. Allow Christ to grow you and expand you. So Saul and Samuel the prophet interact with one another. And so you find that in 1 Samuel chapter 15, verse 20, Saul is getting ready to go to battle with the Amalekites, and Samuel is delaying coming to sacrifice before they go to battle. And so Saul takes it upon himself to become what he is not, which is a preacher. And so he does the sacrifice. And watch what Samuel says, because right after he gets through, here comes Samuel. He says, what have you done? He says, I have obeyed the voice of the Lord and gone on a mission which the Lord sent me and brought back Agag, king of Amalek. I have utterly destroyed the Amalekites, but the people plundered and the sheep and the oxen, the best of the things which have been utterly destroyed, to sacrifice to the Lord your God at Gilgal. So Samuel said, has the Lord as great a delight in burnt offerings and sacrifices as in obeying the voice of the Lord? He says, behold, to obey is better than sacrifice. And he goes on to say, and to heed the voice of God than the fat of rams. For rebellion is as the sin of witchcraft, and stubbornness is as iniquity and idolatry. Because you have rejected the word of the Lord, he has rejected you from being king. Rejected him from being king. And in verse 24, watch this. And then Saul says to Samuel, I have sinned, for I have transgressed the commandment of the Lord and your words, because I feared the people and I obeyed their voice. Wow. Saul would have been king like David. But Saul chose, when he received new life, new wine, the Spirit of God, renewing his spirit, he chose to resist. He chose to be an old wineskin bottle. and it cost him generations of blessing. It cost him the kingdom, and it cost him his life eventually. Before he lost his life, he lost his mind, and he'd be talking to David and just go crazy, throwing spears at David, the future king, for no reason at all, his son-in-law. Have you just gone off on somebody for no reason at all? Have you just flipped? Have you 1 minute praying with them, the next minute cursing them out? Have you been 1 minute nice and a blessing, and the next minute you got to pay me for a ride to church and give me some gas? People will flip on you if you allow the devil to use you, if you allow him to mess with you and to mess with your carnal nature, he will get you. He will cause you to stop expanding. God wants obedience. Somebody say, God wants your obedience. If he says expand, if he says grow, if he says live in a renewed mind and a renewed creation, which you are, and to grow in Christ, not to be a baby forever, then we ought to be doing that. See, you're not expanding, and maybe you're not growing in Christ. And maybe it's because of three reasons. And we see these in the former text, rebellion. Maybe you're just rebelling. Maybe you're just a rebel against God. Rebellion right there, it talks about it as a sin of witchcraft. Witchcraft is manipulation. Maybe you're trying to manipulate your circumstances. Maybe you're trying to do it yourself. Maybe you don't want to link. When people come and say, let's pray, I don't want to pray. I don't want to pray right now. I need to work. I need to get this done. Man, you always want that prayer and say, I ain't got time. I got to hear him get here. You don't have time to stop and pray. To take a moment to speak to God about what you're supposed to be doing. Can somebody say amen? Number two, maybe you're just stubborn. I know we don't have any stubborn people here right now. Amen. It's 10:45. Amen. But maybe you're stubborn, and it talks about it is as the sin of idolatry. Watch this. Idolatry is pride. If we had any prideful people in here, don't raise your hand. Don't. Maybe you're prideful. Maybe you're selfish. Maybe it's all about you. Maybe you're not thinking about helping others and doing unto others as you want them to do unto you. See, when I was growing up, I heard slow obedience is disobedience. Foot dragging. Anybody know what I'm talking about? Yeah. My dad couldn't stand foot dragging. Slow to do this, slow to do that. You're telling me you're being stubborn. You're telling me you don't want to do it. You're being prideful. And God is the same way. If he told you to change your life, change it. How dare we flip out on him if he's giving you a second chance? You know they should have left you. You know you should have been fired, but they stayed. They forgave you. They turned around and didn't fire you and said, I'm going to give you another shot. How dare you walk in with preconditions. Oh, well, I'll stay if you act a little. What? You the one messed up. Oh, I need an extra week of vacation. Boy, I should have laid you off. You need to be happy to still have a job after all that shenanigans that you put on. You got nerve. We're the same way. How do we have nerve when God blessed you, when God saved your life, when God kept you out of hurt, harm, and danger? How dare we put some conditions on him and not follow his word and expand? How dare we do that? Oh, man. Oh, look at your neighbor and say, you came on the right time. You came on the right time. Watch this. Number three, maybe you're just plain out rejecting the word. That you don't believe. That you're just saying, this word ain't about nothing. It's man-made. I don't know why you listening to that. It's just a book. Maybe you are just straight up a non-believer. Maybe that's why you're not growing. Maybe that's why it's not penetrating your heart. Because you have a limestone heart. Fallow ground. But how many people know that the word of God, the spirit of God, will break up that fallow ground on your heart? Can somebody say amen? It will turn it over. It will plant a seed in there. And if you water it, if you allow it, it will grow inside of you, some plant and some water. But it's God's spirit that gives the increase. I need two or three people to just say, stretch me, Lord. Stretch me, God. Oh, stretch me, oh Lord, so I may be more like you, that I may grow in Christ, that I may change for you, God. Oh, I'm tired. I don't want to stay on this level forever. And the only way I can grow is if I allow the new wine of his spirit to expand inside of me. I want to be better this year than last year. I want to be better this time than next time. I want to be better. And if somebody wants to be better with me, somebody needs to just praise the Lord right now and just thank him for stretching. Thank him for stretching you. Watch this in verse 39. I'm hurrying along. Verse 39 in Luke chapter 5, he says, no man having drunk old wine desires new wine. For he says the old is better. The old is better. Can I tell you that new wine initially is sour? New wine initially doesn't taste quite right. But the problem is it needs to age a little bit. It needs to expand and mature and ferment a little bit. And see, we have a lot of people who are sitting, who are old wine bottles, and they're sitting in the audience all the time at churches all over this world, and they're saying, woo, it tastes good. I don't need to expand. I had good church. And man, I had good church, but you go out and live like the devil. I had good church, and you can wave your hands, and you can praise the Lord, but you got a bad attitude. Anybody with me? This is a bad attitude, but watch what the problem is. See, I think the problem is that the old wine, which when it matures, does taste great. Amen. It does taste great, but watch this. You sipping on somebody else's wine. You sipping on grandma wine. Grandma been on her knees for years. Grandma then weathered the storm. Grandma then prayed through death and hurt and anguish and loss. And she has spent years studying the word of God. You sipping on somebody else's wine. Oh, it tastes good when the preacher gets up and starts ministry and you get the goosebumps. You tasting somebody else's wine. It's awesome when the singers get up and they're worshiping God and they're praising him. You're partaking of that. That tastes good. But look at your neighbor and say, you got to get your own wine. You got to get your own wine. And the problem is that when you leave out of church, that's why preachers are talking about all the time, make sure you got it not only in here, but out there. Oh, there ain't no music at home when you go through problems. Can somebody say amen? Brother Smith ain't next to the bed going, he not doing that. He not doing that riding down the street while you crying your eyes out because you just got laid off. Brother Smith ain't there. Hit it, Brother Bill. He not. You don't hear that when somebody leave you. You don't hear that when somebody dies in your family. What you hear is the silence and the silence of the Spirit speaking to you. And God is saying, draw nigh to me and I'll draw nigh to you. He is saying, expand and grow inside. That you don't need to sip on grandma wine or granddad wine. It's good. It tastes great. But you need your own. Look at your neighbor and say, you got to get your own. You got to get your own. And so watch this. The problem is that you have to realize that people love their comfort zones. People love their comfort zones. And they don't want to expand and they don't want to change. But God wants to grow you. God wants to perfect you. Change doesn't feel good to anybody. But God wants you to change. God wants us all to change. And the longer you hang in there with them, the better you'll get. The longer you stay in the Word, the more you mature. Your attitude will get better. Your walk will get better. You'll love more, and people will see the light. You'll shine more. Can somebody say amen? That you have to allow the Spirit of God to stir you up. Can somebody say, stretch me, oh Lord. Can somebody say, I want to be new wine and a new bottle, amen? If you believe that, I need you to give him a hand clap of praise in here. If you believe that God wants you to be better than you were before, then you need to praise him. If you believe that God wants you to be at another level, that's why you come here, not to just sit and listen, but to learn, to grow, so that you can go and be a blessing out there. But watch this. I'm about to close, but I have good news and bad news. Amen. Amen. And I got bad news for the old bottles that you may know. See, the thing is that if you are an old bottle, then you are going to stay loose in your living, loose in your standards. You are not going to be able to handle change. You're not going to be able to handle expansion. That's not your friend. Can somebody say amen? When you're an old bottle, you are prone to burst. You're prone to split. Can you say amen? You can't see potentials. You can't see opportunities anymore. Old bottles can't see the forest for the tree. Old bottles don't understand they got a good thing at home. Old bottles don't understand that they blessed to have a piece of a job. Old bottles are dreamers, and they keep dreaming, but they never do anything because they tired, and they don't want to work, and they don't want to push because they want everything to come to them. How you going to get a job if you don't leave the house? Oh, I'm talking to some people you may know. That how you going to get a job sitting at home? Well, I email somebody. I fax something to somebody. My friends say they're going to hook me up. My friend work at such. You not getting no. Let me move on. And the problem is eventually you're going to end up used up and alone. Can you tell me? Nobody wants something used up. Nobody wants something busted, disgusted. Nobody wants something that they can't grow with. Amen. You know they talking about can't teach an old dog new tricks. You can't repurpose an old bottle. Can you say amen? But see, I have good news too. I got good news for the new bottles, and I'm closing right here. It's that with new bottles who have the new wine, they have realized something that they got to tighten up. Look at your neighbor and say, tighten up. You find that new bottles, they understand what it is to tighten up, and they feel different. How many people feel different in the Lord right now? How many people feel that God is doing something with them? You find out that new bottles with new wine, if you accept it, you are right with being uncomfortable with life. You're uncomfortable, and it's okay. You can be uncomfortable at the family reunion when everybody drunk and falling out. You can keep your composure. You all right feeling uncomfortable at work when people are gossiping and backbiting and skipping out and hustling and taking two-hour lunches. You are sitting there working hard. You are all right with being uncomfortable when you're in the boardroom and everybody's talking about finances and this and that, and you over in the corner praying. You're all right with being uncomfortable in the culture. Yes, man and man, women and women, this and that, hustling and money and on and on and on. But you okay because you know the Word of God. Somebody say, stretch me. Oh, Lord.
Oh, Lord.
And watch this, you find this is the greatest thing about being a new bottle with some new wine. That at the end of the day, we know one thing's coming, and it's called expansion. I don't know if there's anybody in here right now like myself, but I want to expand. I want to grow. I don't want to stay like this. I don't want to stay at this level. I don't want to stay acting like this. I don't want to stay. I want to go higher. Somebody say higher. I want to go further. Somebody say further. But God, I need you to stretch me. And if I have anybody in here who want to be better, if it's anybody in here who wants God to stretch them and expand them and use them and take them further to another level, to another place, somebody need to praise the Lord in here. Somebody need to bless his name.
Hallelujah.
Somebody need to say glory to his name. Stretch me one more time, God. Stretch me. God, tell it's uncomfortable. Stretch me, Lord, till I cannot adjust. God, I need you, God. I need him to stretch me further. I need him to take me higher. See, the pastor shouldn't be like this 5 years from now, 2 years from now, 1 year from now. I ought to be better with people. I ought to be kinder, more gentle. I ought to be more focused. I ought to be better. I ought to be more mature. See, if you have been a saint for a long time, boy, you ought to be the most gentle, patient, loving person. And if you're not, God wants to renew you. Can I tell you, that's what it was all about with Christ. Christ wanted to bring us new life. Amen. He died that you could be a new creature in Christ. He died that you could serve him and love him. Yeah. Yeah. You may feel uncomfortable growing. You may feel awkward because, see, you don't enjoy the same things you used to. You're not into the same things you used to be into. You're not as popular with your people like you used to be. So you're uncomfortable with yourself, and you may say, I don't know quite where I'm at, and I can't get my bearings because, see, I was comfortable in my old ways. But I'm on unsure footing in my new ways and in this new life. But I want to let you know that the Spirit of God has not left you nor forsaken you. That his Spirit is the great counselor, is the Spirit of truth. That God is love. He's going to hold your hand all the way through. Can somebody say amen?